On March 30, 1981, a would-be assassin fired 6 shots at President Ronald Reagan outside the Washington Hilton Hotel, 2 miles from the White House. Washington Post reporter Del Wilber, author of Rawhide Down, The Near Assassination of Ronald Reagan, met us on the sidewalk where the shooting took place to tell his story of that day.
She shoots 6 shots. The first one hits Jim Brady, the press secretary, in the head. He falls down. The second one hits Tom Delahanty, who's a D.C. police officer, who had turned around to check on the president's progress. He gets hit in the back, falls down, screams, "I'm hit!" Hits the ground. Now the path to the president is clear. It's wide open. Hinckley has an effective range of 20 to 30 feet. He's done target practice. He can hit stationary targets 20 to 30 feet. Jerry Parr, the lead Secret Service agent, Reagan's lead Secret Service agent, meanwhile, in 0.4 seconds, I've tried to time it, it's very difficult, but about 0.4 seconds, has grabbed the President of the United States the moment he hears the gunfire, thrusts him behind Tim McCarthy, who is now another Secret Service agent, who swiveled his body, takes a bullet in the chest. The first bullet hits Brady, the second one hits Delahanty, the third one flies over Reagan's head and lodges in a window of that building across the street. They actually recover it. There's a kind of a cool photo of the little bullet hole in one of those lobby windows. The fourth one hits McCarthy, who's turned like this to take the bullet. He's not wearing a bulletproof vest. Hits him right in the chest, bends him around. Just as they're behind them, Jerry Parr credits Tim McCarthy with helping save the president's life at that moment. The next bullet hits the window of the armored limo window, so the bulletproof window, just as you can see the president flashing behind it with Jerry Parr pushing him in the limousine. And the sixth one cracks across the parking lot. No one knows where that one went at that moment. Then Jerry Parr gets him in the limo, someone slams the door shut, and so they drive away and they head straight out this way towards Connecticut Avenue at that moment. What they didn't know at the time was Hinckley's final shot, the sixth one, had ricocheted off the back quarter panel of the limousine. Actually, they recovered the black paint and matched it to the limousine off the bullet that was later removed from the president. And as Reagan's diving, it hits him right here on this side, right around here, and lodges an inch from his heart.
We're going to get in a taxi, yep, and follow the ride of the limousine. And do you think this is roughly the way it was parked?
This was roughly pretty close. It was this direction, like this, out there towards T Street. So Jerry Parr, the agent, you know, looks out the window and sees there's a pockmark on that door, on that window, where the bullet has, your window. And he also notices the 3 guys down the sidewalk as they pull away. He goes, "Now this is bad. There's been a shooting." He props Reagan up in the seat you're in, props him up, kind of like this. Reagan's kind of like this, like a tired basketball player. And he runs his body inside his coat, and his hands through his hair to check, see if there's any blood. And there's no blood, so he feels pretty good. And he tells the driver to tell on his radio, because Jerry Parr has lost his radio. It bust off from his sleeve mic in the melee, and he lost his transponder. And so he can't use his radio to tell everyone what they're doing. So he tells Drew and Rue to use the microphone here to radio down to headquarters that they're heading back to White House. Actually, they use the code word Crown. And he takes the radio from Drew and Rue and says, "Rawhide is okay. Rawhide is okay." Rawhide is Ronald Reagan's code name. That's where I got the title of the book from.
"Rawhide is okay. Follow up. Rawhide is okay. You want to go to the hospital or back to the White House? We're going to Crown. Back to the White House. Back to the White House. Rawhide is okay."
Right about here, Jerry Parr realizes that something's wrong with the president because he's having trouble breathing. He says, "I'm having trouble breathing. I don't know. What's wrong? Are you having a heart attack? Is this your heart?" And, you know, Reagan says, "I don't think so." And then he starts dabbing blood from his lips, and it's bright and frothy blood. And from Parr's training, he knows that means it's oxygen. It's probably from the lungs. That isn't good. And so Jerry Parr has to make a call.
"Go to Gordon Park.
Roger, we
want
to go to the emergency room of George Washington."
"That's a Roger.
Go to George Washington fast."
"Roger, Sergeant Barrow,
Quincy. Get an ambulance. I mean, get the stretcher out there.
What time, Jack? You copy?
GW? Correctly, make the call.
Horsepower.
Because he can't say on the radio, Reagan's hurt. They don't use Reagan's name. They know people and assassins and news media can be listening to the open radio communications, hence they use the code names. And so they abandon Crown, the White House, go to the hospital.